Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, and welcome to part 4 of the decree and predestination, in which I speak about al-lawh al-mahfuz. And this is part 2 of that talk. And I finished in the previous talk when I spoke about what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala meant when he said that he wipes off or erases what he wills and retains and confirms what he wills. And with him is the mother of the book. And I said that the mother of the book is not, or the mother book is not where he wrote whatever was going to happen, but rather more it is in that mother book that the original Quran, or the most original Quran before it gets translated into other languages. I said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took from that Quran, the original one, and he turned it into Hebrew and it became the Torah. And then when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave it to Jesus, son of Mary, in Aramaic, it was the Gospel. And then when he gave it to our messenger in Arabic, it was Al-Quran. But the original text, as I said, we don't know what it is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned something about it in Al-Quran, and I'll get back to it later. So from now on, whenever somebody mentions this ayah, يَمْحُ اللَّهُ مَا يَشَاءُ, that Allah wipes off whatever he pleases, وَيُثْبِتْ, and he affirms whatever he wills, وَعِنْدَهُ أُمُّ الْكِتَابِ, and with him is the mother book. If they tell you the actions of a human are written here, and if you ask Allah, you make dua, it will efface or it will erase something there, just know it's not true, that this person has just copy-pasted what was wrongly said before. And now you know better about this topic here. Now, the question is, what has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really written in that book where he wrote things, the laws that were going to happen? This belief here is present in all kinds of books that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or al-lawh al-mahfuz, is in what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written everything to happen. So much so that our scholars have designed 4 pillars to the belief of al-qadr, the decree and predestination. And they say that if any Muslim doesn't believe in one or more of these pillars, this person cannot be considered a Muslim. The pillars are that ilmullah al-azali, and this is Allah's eternal comprehensive knowledge. And point number 2, or pillar number 2, is the writing in al-lawh al-mahfuz, that Allah wrote that knowledge in the guarded tablet. I will explain a little bit about this. And then the third pillar is the mashia, the divine will. What Allah willed to happen was going to happen, and what he didn't will to happen will not happen. And this is where the confusion comes in, that Allah erases and affirms. They thought it was talking about this point here, but it is not. And then point number 4 is al-khalq, the creation of what Allah has willed that it will exist or won't exist. Needless to say that these 4 components that they have allocated to the belief in the decree and predestinations were designed on the 3rd century, around 244 and above. To have an idea, in the Christian era calendar, the one that we follow in Europe, we're talking about the 8th century, and we are in 2019, so that is 11 centuries ago that these laws were made. And for the last 11 centuries, we have not moved an inch. Again, and they said that if someone does not believe in one of those pillars, is considered a kafir. Al-Mutawakkil was the king under which all these sciences were designed. Let me tell you a story about Al-Mutawakkil. Even though he supported Ahmad ibn Hanbal, even though he ended the conflict of the creation of Al-Quran that took place between Ahmad ibn Hanbal, and if you don't know who Ahmad ibn Hanbal is the leader of the Hanbali, or what's followed today in Saudi Arabia, school of thought. So Ahmad ibn Hanbal existed at that time. This leader who was close to Ahmad ibn Hanbal, in the year 244, there was some scholars, and I'm not going to bore you with the name. This event or this incident is narrated in all books of our history. This man, Al-Mutawakkil, the king of that time, was extremely hateful of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Subhanallah, until our days, it's unbelievable why they hate the offspring of Rasulullah. And when I say Ali ibn Abi Talib, anyone that is descended of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Al-Mutawakkil brought one great scholar, and anyone at that time there that vouched his love for Ali, for example, even in our times, if you say, oh, I love Ali, what happens to your mind? You straight away think of the Shia. Subhanallah, it's unbelievable, it's unbelievable. But anyhow, so this man, Al-Mutawakkil, the king, brought a great scholar who used to defend Ali and Al-Hasan and Al-Hussein and was not a Shia with the content of Iran and all that kind of stuff. Anyone in the past, for your information, that loved Ali and Al-Hussein, Al-Hasan Al-Hussein, Fatima and all these things were called a Shia. So he brought this man. And to torture him further, he delegated him to teach his kids before they would bring scholars and have them teach the children of the king. And this man, the poor guy being tortured, punched and all that kind of stuff, he accepted that, okay, I will teach your kids. One day, Al-Mutawakkil, Billah, Al-Mutawakkil means the one who relies on Allah. Religion has always been, these big shiny titles have always been used to blind people. In our times, any king of Saudi Arabia is Khadim al-Haramain, is the subservient, is the caretaker of the two holy shrines. And the moment they say that, you link that to Islam, and that's, and then the king does whatever he does. Anyhow, so he brings this educator, this sheikh, and asks him a very important question. And he tells him, are my two kids, A and B, are they better to you than Al-Hasan or Al-Hussein? And the scholar, subhanAllah, you compare the grandchildren of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to your children, and you're asking me if your children are better than Al-Hasan and Al-Hussein? And then this scholar said to the king, said to the king, Qumbur. Qumbur is a servant of Ali, radiallahu anhu. And this is a great man, Qumbur. But anyhow, he said to him, Qumbur, in my eyesight, is far better than your two children. I'm not even going to compare Al-Hasan al-Hussein to your kids. You know what this king did to this man? And now you will understand why Jamal Khashoggi was killed in an embassy, sold half alive, and bagged and disposed of the way they did. It's because this is how the Hanbali, Wahhabi, Salafi school of thought runs. It's based on terror. This king ordered the Turks, because that back then, that's when Turkey army started, because they embraced Islam, they became a force, and Al-Mutawakkil was one of these people. But anyhow, so he ordered his army to take this scholar and detach his tongue from his mouth, from the back of his mouth. It's not cut it. It's these people, imagine them now. They have this Muslim great scholar. Just because he happens to love Ali al-Hasan al-Hussein, he doesn't curse the companions. Nothing of what the Shia do today. It's just like myself. I love Ali al-Hasan al-Hussein and I defend them. In the eyesight of the Shia, the moment of the Sunni, the Salafi, the moment they hear me say these things to them, I am a Shia when I am not, subhanAllah. But anyhow, so he ordered his armies, his soldiers, to detach the tongue of this scholar from the back of his head and then kill him. And they did. While Ahmed ibn Hanbal was friend of this man. But what interests us at this point here is that the Islam we believe in today, with everything that you know, including the Salafism and everything that you know, was designed at that era. So anyhow, so has Allah truly written something in the Lawh al-Mahfuz and the evidences that he bring from the Quran to prove their point? Because whenever you try to find the evidence from the Quran that Allah pre-wrote everything, including our actions, you are always directed to few chief ayat in the book of Allah, and they tell you that these ayat refer to the fact that Allah has written. These few ayat are scattered in Al-Quran here and there, and oftentimes they are just mentioned without any mentioning of the different meanings of this ayah. They just give you one meaning, as if that ayah carries one meaning. As if that ayah is muhkam, it's a closed ayah as we spoke, and it doesn't have co-similar meanings. In fact, they are just presented from one side, this ayat, the side that supports the argument of the speaker or the Salafis or all that kind of stuff. And this is without any shame in hiding the other meanings, because the other meanings are knowledge. Many great scholars have been killed because they opposed some of the meanings that we are being taught today. Many of these scholars have been killed. Many of these scholars have been labeled as all titles of disbelief. It's unbelievable, from kafir to everything. Only to mention an example, At-Tabari. Who doesn't know At-Tabari? Tafsir of At-Tabari. He is a great sheikh. Even Ibn Taymiyyah alayhi rahmatullah and all the great scholars, even in our times, agree that At-Tabari is something that you've never seen alike. And his tafsir is unbelievable in his tariqh, in the way he deals with fiqh, in all that kind of stuff. At-Tabari, again, he lived at the same era under the leadership of Al-Mutawakkil. Okay, a little bit later on though, but hey, it's in that century where Islam was designed. At-Tabari one day wrote a book about the differences of the school of thought of the great scholars, al-fuqaha, that is Abu Hanifa, Malik, and al-Shafi'i. But he did not include Ahmad ibn Hanbal as a scholar of fiqh. The school of thought of Ahmad ibn Hanbal, i.e. the Saudi in our days, they went berserk and they went mad. They went one day to his, first of all, it started with this. Before, they used to have the mihbara and the miqlama. Mihbara is a small pot where you can have the ink, and then you dig the pen, and then you write. So that ink carrier, the man, alayhi rahmatullah, was first stoned alive with those ink carriers. People smacked and hit them. The people, it's not the regular people, the scholars of the Hanbali school of thought. And I insist, the Hanbali school of thought is what's in Saudi Arabia today. Okay, Bin Baz, Ibn Uthaymeen, and anyone from Saudi Arabia or that claims to be Salafi is nothing else but a disguised Hanbali school of thought followers. And later on, the hate went so big for At-Tabari that they stoned him alive in his own home. He couldn't come out because there was just way too many stones blocking the door. The worst thing is, when At-Tabari died, the Muslims could not take At-Tabari to the masjid and pray on him janazah. Worse, At-Tabari could not be buried in daylight. He was sneaked out from his home to some unknown place and buried. Why? Because the Hanbali school of thought, as I said, the Saudi school of thought, would have dug him and maybe did something worse to him. So don't worry that Jamal Khashoggi was killed like that. This runs in the blood of the Hanbali school of thought, this terror. So the cheating of presenting you just with one meaning, one side of the ayah, is unbelievable, or one hadith or anything that ever they preach. So, but anyhow, the act of hiding these meanings, and it gets your head really aching. That's why if you want to do some researches about any topic, don't take anything that comes from the Middle East as that's the absolute truth. Dig. The truth is out there. There are many books that speak about that, and the books are still present these days. So all you gotta do is just research until you get there. Because the Islam we got today is the Islam of the kings and governors and employed sheikhs that take a monthly check for the Islam that they provide to the masses. And what kind of Islam they would preach, this is why we Muslims, after 14 centuries, it looks like we have never had an Islam in our possession and that it was just handed over to us as new, and we are confused. But anyhow, let us go quickly through 7 ayat that are used to prove that Allah had written all that is to happen in Al-Lawh Al-Mahfuz. Let's see these evidences. Are they really true ones? Or there is another side to to this story. And I encourage you again one more time, take pen and paper. Maybe you listen to this talk the very first time to get the feel of it, but please do re-listen the second time and the third time and take notes. These notes will turn you into a happy person, and Allah will be pleased with you on Judgment Day because you are using His Quran as He wants you to, not as those government scholars want you to filter your Islam through them. And filtering our Islam through them is as evil and vile as you would have a coffee machine making you a cappuccino without the filter. Go enjoy that cappuccino. Anyway, ayah number one is in Surah Al-Hajj, and Surah Al-Hajj is the Surah number 22, and the chief ayah is the ayah 70, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَلَمْ تَعْلَمْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْلَمُ مَا فِي السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Don't you know that Allah knows all that is in the heavens and the earth? إِنَّ ذَلِكَ فِي كِتَابٍ. Clearly, all that is contained in a book. إِنَّ ذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ يَسِيرٌ. That is indeed easy for Allah. So this is the first ayah that he says. So because everything is known to Allah in the heavens and the earth, and all of that is in a book, and then all that is easy for Allah. This proves that everything is in that Lawh al-Mahfuz. The ayah number two is in Surah Al-Hadid, the Surah number 57. I'm just going to tell you the ayah, then we go through them. The ayah 57 and the ayah is number 22. مَا أَصَابَ مِن مُصِيبَةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا فِي أَنفُسِكُمْ إِلَّا فِي كِتَابٍ مِن قَبْلِ أَن نَبْرَأَهَا. Whenever a calamity occurs on earth or in yourselves, except it is in a book, before we bring it into being. إِنَّ ذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ يَسِيرٌ. That is indeed easy for Allah. Ayah number 3 is in Surah Al-An'am, and that is Surah number 6, and the ayah is 38. وَمَا مِن دَابَّةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا طَائِرٍ يَطِيرُ بِجَنَاحَيْهِ. And no animal that crawls on earth, and no bird that flies with its two wings, except our communities like you. مَا فَرَّطْنَا فِي الْكِتَابِ مِن شَيْءٍ. We have not overlooked anything in the book. ثُمَّ إِلَى رَبِّهِمْ يُحْشَرُونَ. Then to the Lord will they all be assembled. Ayah number 4, and that is the ayah in Surah An-Naml 27, and the ayah is 75. وَمَا مِنْ غَائِبَةٍ فِي السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ إِلَّا فِي كِتَابٍ مُبِينٍ. And whatever hidden in the heaven or earth, that is in a clarifying book. So all of it is in a clarifying book. The ayah number 5, and that is in Surah Yunus, and Surah number 10, and the ayah's number is 61. وَمَا تَكُونُ فِي شَأْنٍ وَمَا تَتْلُو مِنْهُ مِنْ قُرْآنٍ. And in whatever matter you are in, and whatever part of the Qur'an you are reading, وَلَا تَعْمَلُونَ مِنْ عَمَلٍ, and whatever work you are doing, إِلَّا كُنَّا عَلَيْكُمْ شُهُودًا. But we are witness on you when you undertake whatever Allah has mentioned in that ayah. إِذْ تُفِيضُونَ فِيهِ. Whatever you do that. And then Allah says, وَمَا يَعْزُبُ عَنْ رَبِّكَ مِنْ مِثْقَالِ ذَرَّةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا فِي السَّمَاءِ. And nothing accepts nor hides from your Lord, not even the weight of an atom of dust in the heavens, or nor less or greater, i.e. on the earth as well, except it is in a clarifying book. إِلَّا فِي كِتَابٍ مُبِينٍ. The ayah number 6 is the ayah in Surah At-Tawbah, and the ayah is number 51. The Surah At-Tawbah is number 9. Allah says, قُلْ لَنْ يُصِيبَنَا إِلَّا مَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَنَا. Say, nothing will befall us, or nothing will happen to us, or nothing can strike us, except what Allah has decreed for us. هُوَ مَوْلَانَا. He is our protector. وَعَلَى اللَّهِ فَلْيَتَوَكَّلِ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. And let the believers then put all their trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ayah number 7, and that is last but certainly not least. Okay, here bear in mind that I have chosen 7, and with these 7 you can apply them to any other ayah that faces you. These are the major ayahs, so to speak. But I will, in other talks inshallah, I will cover other ayahs that deal with other topics. But for this number 7, it is in Surah Fatir, and that is the ayah Surah 35, and the ayah is number 11, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاللَّهُ خَلَقَكُم مِّن تُرَابٍ, and Allah created you from dust. ثُمَّ مِن نُطْفَةٍ, then from a drop of sperm. But here it doesn't say sperm as such, it says nutfa. And a nutfa, even though the scholars mean it as a sperm, but what about the woman? It actually means a drop. And that drop is from the women. It could be a drop of blood, and it could be a drop of sperm. So the general meaning of nutfa is a drop. But again, the masculine mentality turned into a drop of sperm. But anyhow, we're going to say min nutfa from both man and women. ثُمَّ جَعَلَكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا, then he made you into pairs, man and woman, and you know, same height and different people, colors. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made us into pairs. وَمَا تَحْمِلُ مِنْ أُنْثَى وَلَا تَضَعُ إِلَّا بِعِلْمِهِ, and no female conceives nor delivers a child except with his knowledge, i.e. the knowledge of Allah. وَمَا يُعَمَّرُ مِنْ مُعَمَّرٍ وَلَا يُنْقَصُ مِنْ عُمُرِهِ إِلَّا فِي كِتَابٍ, and no one's life is made long or cut short but is in a book. إِنَّ ذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ يَسِيرٌ, that is certainly very easy for Allah. Notice whenever Allah mentions these things, He always says that these are certainly easy for Allah. So basically these are the seven major ayat that deal with the topic, and you will find them present in so many books. So now let us go with each ayah and see, does Allah truly mean that He has written everything that is to happen to you in a book, and that you are only just like a computer, just being coded to do what has been written, just like the computer of your car? It can only do what the programmer has told it to do. You can't suddenly have your computer, your car computer, cook you a pizza or do whatever you do, whatever it does. It just tells you, it tells you what it has been programmed to do. So has Allah truly done that? He programmed us with just follow instructions. Well, number one, the ayah from Surah Al-Hajj, and the ayah is number 70. Hajj is 22 again, where Allah says, "Alam ta'lam anna Allah ya'lamu ma fi as-sama'i wal ard?" Don't you know that Allah knows all that is in the heaven and the earth? Inna dhalika fi kitab. Clearly, that is contained in a book. That is indeed very easy for Allah. When this ayah is extracted from its content, from its what the purpose it serves, the topic it covers, it can take and give a complete different meanings to what Allah meant. Do you know why we follow Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Why we follow? Because he is a messenger. A messenger has no authority over the message he delivers. Just like an ambassador, the ambassador cannot just say anything he likes. He speaks on behalf of a country. The ambassador is the facade of that country. And the same example applies to a messenger. The messenger is nothing else but a facade to what Allah wants from us. The messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, delivered the Quran to us, and the messenger became the Quran, the practical Quran that people saw. In normal circumstances, the sunnah of this prophet, of this messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, should be exactly the same thing as the teachings of Al Quran. So whenever something doesn't work properly with the Quran, we can't say, "Oh, Allah has revealed another revelation to the messenger, and that is the hadith, the sunnah, and the revelation of the Quran." And later on, I will explain in this talk here about the hadith Qudsi, and the Quran, so that you understand the difference, where that difference is, and why we are still the worst people when it comes to understanding our religion. But back to our place here. Therefore, to truly understand what Allah wants from us, we ought to read Al-Quran, practice Al-Quran, as exactly like a messenger would, with no pre-assumption, nothing at all of what we want to do. We just do what Allah wants from us. Okay? So let us put this ayah with her sisters and see what we can derive from it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Hajj talks about a particular issue. He says, وَإِنْ جَادَلُوكَ فَقُلِ اللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ. And if they argue with you as regards, because in Surah Al-Hajj, Allah speaks about the slaughtering of animals and how the Arabs have made certain things haram and certain things halal. But you can apply this ruling to anything because Allah has not specified the slaughtering. So whenever you are argued with, then you can take this approach. So what they say, Allah says, and وَإِنْ جَادَلُوكَ, if they argue with you, say to them, Ya Muhammad, answer them, Allah knows best of what you do. Now, pay attention. Allah says to messenger, answer them with this. And the messenger answers that with what Allah tells him. The messenger was not free to say as he pleased. So Quraysh at that time would tell him something, Rasulullah will keep quiet until the revelation comes. And as is this case here, Allah says, tell them. Every time you hear faqul, or say, or tell them, it means that is Rasul, that's the job of an ambassador, that's the job of a messenger. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala carries on. Allahu yahkumu baynakum yawm al-qiyamati fima kuntum fihi takhtalifun. Allah will judge among you on the day of resurrection concerning matters about which you disagreed. And I'm starting here from the ayah 68 to get to work our way to the number 70. So I'll read both ayat, and if they argue with you, say Allah knows best what you do. Allah will judge among you on the day of resurrection concerning matters about which you disagreed. And then Allah tells the messenger, أَلَمْ تَعْلَمْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْلَمُ مَا فِي السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ. And this Rasulullah ﷺ is going to tell it to the other people. Then he would turn to them and he tells them, don't you know that Allah knows all that is in the heaven and the earth? And this includes the disagreement, the debate, the arguing that took place between Rasulullah ﷺ. إِنَّ ذَلِكَ فِي كِتَابٍ. All that is in a book. I.e. what you have spoken about, what you disagreed upon, what you argued about, that has been registered in a book. That book is what Allah will give us on day of judgment. Don't we all say, Ya Allah, give us our books on the right hand? Then the act of arguing was documented on both people or on both parties, on those from Quraysh that argued with Rasulullah, and from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam perspective in his book, it's been written. On judgment day, Allah will judge between the two parties, and then we will look in our books which is the winner. So that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, inna dhalika, i.e. that argument of yours is in a book. This book is explained elsewhere in Surah Yasin, that all Muslims say, oh, we should recite Yasin, Yasin, but they don't understand it. But in Surah Yasin, the Surah number 36, in the ayah 12, Allah speaks about the book of actions. And he says, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى, on judgment day, وَنَكْتُبُ مَا قَدَّمُوا وَآثَارَهُمْ. It is certainly us, i.e. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who resurrects the dead and writes what they sent forth, i.e. the actions we do today, we're sending them for judgment day because we're going to see them on judgment day. And what they leave behind as traces, for example, someone who makes pornographic movies and they die, and people carry on watching the movies after them, meaning people will sin by watching pornography. Guess what's going to happen? The person who made the movie, his book of action does not close at the time of death. It remains open and all the sins will be added. Also, if someone does an act of goodness, builds an orphanage, a hospital, builds something that benefits, invents something, invents the car, the plane, invents something that benefits humanity, and they die, their book of actions does not close. It remains open. And all what people do keeps being added there until judgment day. This is why subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَكُلَّ شَيْءٍ, and all that has been happening, that been done in your life and after your life, and you get the traces of what you have done, أَحْصَيْنَاهُ, we have recorded, fi imamin mubin, in a perfect clear record. And that clear record is called Al-Imam Al-Mubin. It's a huge book. Only Allah knows how big it is. And it contains the actions done by humans all of them until the last man. My actions now, as I speak now, are being recorded in Al-Imam Al-Mubin. And then on Judgment Day, Allah will take from Al-Imam Al-Mubin my actions, put them in a collection of acts to me, and gives them to me, and I open my book, and I read my book of action. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the Messenger of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, don't you know that Allah knows all that is in the heaven and the earth, including your arguments and what they do? Then clearly what they are doing or what they have done has been recorded in a clean contained book. That is Al-Imam Al-Mubin, the book of actions, not a book that Allah has created before time, as they call Al-Lawh Al-Mahfuz, and Allah wrote everything to happen. This is absolutely untrue. So my dear sisters and my brothers, when you read this ayah, أَلَمْ تَعْلَمْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْلَمُ مَا فِي السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ, don't you know that Allah knows all that is in the heaven and the earth? إِنَّ ذَلِكَ فِي كِتَاب, all that has been of the, Allah is talking about the actions here and what the malaika do, what happens, is all recorded. Because you see, on Judgment Day, well, let's say someone here does an act of goodness, and the angels collect all the elements of that act. They will collect what you were dressing, your state of mind, why you did what you did, the people that invested in you, either in good, in bad, the position of the sun in the sky, the wind, the air, the pollution, which galaxy was close to the sun. All that is documented. Because, for example, when the full moon is on, our chemistry changes in our minds. So when someone makes an error there, it's different than when they do it when the moon is completely passive. So all those elements are gathered together, and on Judgment Day, in the total justice of Allah, all these elements will be looked at before Allah issues a ruling on you. And this is why he says, أَلَمْ تَعْلَمْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْلَمُ مَا فِي السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ, don't you know that Allah knows all that is in the heaven and the earth that might affect you in what you do? And then clearly your acts and all that is contained in a clear book. And gathering all this information, this huge, majestic, unbelievable amount of information about one act, all that, إِنَّ ذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ يَسِيرٌ, all that is indeed very easy for Allah. Today a murder gets committed and we put like thousands of soldiers or policemen, and we only gather this much of information, and they have no clue where XYZ or 300 years or whatever, or the position of the sky. We've got no clue about all that, except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whenever someone mentions this ayah to you now, tell them, start from ayah 68 from above and read on to build a good understanding of the ayah. Now let us go to the next one, and that is the ayah number 2 from Surah Al-Hadid. Surah Al-Hadid is 57, and the ayah in particular is the ayah 22. And this is, I hear this a lot. مَا أَصَابَ مِن مُصِيبَةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا فِي أَنفُسِكُمْ إِلَّا فِي كِتَابٍ مِن قَبْلِ أَن نَبْرَأَهَا. Whatever calamity occurs on earth or in yourselves, except it is in a book before you bring it into being, that is, here you go, إِنَّ ذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ يَسِيرٌ, that is indeed easy for Allah. One of the most misunderstood words in the book of Allah, amongst many others, and they are not yet resolved. The problem again with our shuyukh is when the sheikh goes to the university, and to me any university in Medina, in Mecca, and all this Al-Azhar and all these things, I call them mass production sheikhs. Is sheikhs mostly like massively produced? And if the teacher likes a student, even if the student sucks, big deal, but at the end they will give him the diploma or the degree. So one of those elements, and always remember, at the university it's one teacher that teaches 1,000 people. When the teacher gets it wrong, it's 1,000 other sheikhs that get it wrong. It's billions upon billions of Muslims that will get it wrong. So one of the most misunderstood words in the book of Allah, amongst many others, is the word book, kitab, and kataba. And they always translate kitab into a book and kataba into writing. And there is a huge misunderstanding, because in English or in other languages, writing means you carry a pen and you write, right? But in Arabic, it has a completely different meaning. And the true meaning of the word kataba in the pure Arabic, in the tongue of people, is to, it's not like writing, but rather is to bring things together to get something out from them. Is to bring the variety of elements, and then all that variety of elements, you put them together and you make something out of them. For example, a collection of men in the army, in Arabic, it is called a katiba. Katiba is the gathering of number of men, set number of men, and they form a unit. That unit is, in Arabic, is called katiba. A collection of many pages in Arabic is called a book. A place that holds a collection of books is called maktaba, a library. A place that contains a collection of things that help you do your job is called maktab, the office. A collection of letters to make a word, when you write a word, you put a collection of letters, and that's why it's called kataba. Here it doesn't mean it's ink on paper. What it means is you have collected letters from the alphabet, and when you collected them together, when you gather them together, they form a meaning. So the word kataba is never intended that is written, but rather it is a series of events when all gathered together, they form one thing. So when you find this verb in the Quran and you are faced with this verb in the Quran, always understand it is a collection of things rather than written literally ink on paper. Allah in His book kept this word as is and with the meaning of collection. The angels collect all your deeds. They don't just write them in a book, ink on paper, and erase and all that kind of stuff. It doesn't happen like that. What the angels do is this. When you do an act, the angels, they write that act and they write everything surrounding that act. For example, if you get angry, you spend the rest of the day angry. Why? Because someone upset you at the beginning of the day, and then you do some stupid things that you usually don't do. For example, you get mad at your kid for no reason. Just because the way of your thinking, the way your feelings are, they are scattered all around. A woman, when she gets her menstruation, hormones change in the body, we all get and react differently to these hormones. Well, when the angels write that, they don't just say, for example, oh, you got angry. No, they will speak about the state of your health, how you woke up, what you were dressed, what you ate, the weather, it's a plethora, it's infinity of elements that they all collect them. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the angels, kiraman, katibin. Katibin is not writing, it's collecting whatever you do. So here, again, understand this term and your life will become easier, and you will understand the Quran far more better than a lot of people out there. Therefore, a book, kitab, is nothing else but a collection of elements that speak about the same topic to reach at the end a conclusion that can yield some outcome, some results. For example, kitab al-salat, which in English is translated into the book of salat. If you have this book, go and get it. It's Riyadu Salihin of Imam al-Nawawi alayhi rahmatullah. When you open the book, you will find Kitab al-Tahara, the chapter of al-Tahara, the book of al-Tahara, Kitab al-Sawm, Kitab, and throughout the book, every time he starts a new chapter about a particular topic, he calls it a book. So here we have loads of book within a book. Now, what an-Nawawi means and what the Arabs understand with this, kitab is a collection of ayat from the Quran, of hadith, that serve one single purpose. This meaning is reinforced in many parts of the Quran. Listen to this ayah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the job of the angels. And he says, أَمْ يَحْسَبُونَ أَنَّا لَا نَسْمَعُ سِرَّهُمْ وَنَجْوَهُمْ. Do they reckon that we do not hear their secret talks and their whispering counsels? And then Allah says, بَلَا, yet, indeed, وَرُسُولُنَا لَدَيْهِمْ يَكْتُبُونَ. And our messengers, the angels, are with them collecting everything that they do. And that collection, the whole of it, is translated or written into a book. Written here does not mean ink on paper. If you take your computer, you write a letter on your computer, where is the ink, where is the paper? It's a way of expression, okay? I'm writing a message to somebody and you are on your WhatsApp. It's no longer, what you are saying is, I am collecting a series of letters, then a series of words, then a series of paragraphs, and all these will help me express myself. And this is what exactly the term write, or in Arabic, kataba, means. In another ayah in the Quran, in Surah Al-A'raf, that's number 7, and the ayah 145, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about Musa when he was given the tablets, Allah says in Surah Al-A'raf, وَكَتَبْنَا لَهُ فِي الْأَلْوَاحِ مِنْ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ مَوْعِظَةً وَتَفْصِيلًا. And we wrote for him on the tablets the fundamentals of everything, all the commands and explanations of all things. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَخُذْهَا بِقُوَّةٍ وَأْمُرْ قَوْمَكَ يَأْخُذُ بِأَحْسَنِهَا. Then hold on to it, ya Musa, very firmly, i.e. apply the law that is in this tablet, in those tablets, and command your people to take the best and follow the best out of what's in there. سَأُرِيكُمْ دَارَ الْفَاسِقِينَ. I will soon show you, in the children of Israel, the homes of the rebellious people. The sad thing that we face today as part of this Islam, the cultural, the oppressive Islam, is that our sheikhs these days claim and preach that the Torah, they will tell you 4 things have been created by Allah directly. One of them is the Torah, or the tablets handed to Musa alayhi salam, and they say that Allah has written whatever is in there with his own hands. I.e., when Moses alayhi salam read in the tablets, he saw the handwriting of Allah. Wallahi al-azim, sometimes I leave this to when I speak about Allah, it's better than. And then they say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the arsh with his own hand. The Jannah is created by the hand of Allah. And Adam alayhi salam is created with the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is purely untrue. This is why Al-Qurtubi alayhi rahmatullah in his book of tafsir said that the writer on the tablets given to Moses alayhi salam were written by Jibreel alayhi salam. And then he added something that he speculated and it became a religion today, and he said the pen which Jibreel used to write on the tablets given to Moses is the same pen that Allah wrote with on the preserved tablets. And what Al-Qurtubi speculated became a religion for us today. And of course, this is absolutely untrue. The true meaning of that is that, and we collected for him, i.e. for Musa alayhi salam, all the Ten Commandments that given to him were all put together. They all were collected on the tablets. The fundamentals of everything are the commandments and explanation of were all collected, and they formed the religion that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to the children of Israel. And then all those commands were written, which is part of the process, so that Musa alayhi salam reads in that. In other words, Musa was given a collection of laws printed on the tablet. And these things were the Ten Commandments that also exist in Al-Quran, and they also exist in the Gospel of Jesus alayhi salam. So let us go back now to our ayah in Surah Al-Hadid 57 and dig out the meaning from it, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that whatever calamity occurs on earth or on yourselves, it is in a book before we bring it into being that is indeed easy for Allah. What is the true meaning of this ayah? Okay, example. Allah has written in the book of laws that gravity pulls down. Okay, that's the law. That law doesn't differentiate between a baby, an old man, or a girl or a woman. It doesn't differentiate between things, and it doesn't differentiate between a pen and a car. It doesn't differentiate. It just acts whenever all conditions have been fulfilled. And so is the same sort for diseases as well. death, road collision, and everything. A road collision between cars does not happen until and unless all elements have been gathered together. And then the road collision is the final product of that. So what Allah is telling us in this ayah is that the fundamentals and conditions of anything bad that can happen in the heavens or in the humans is all gathered in a book, in a series of laws. And as soon as the conditions are fulfilled, Allah then follows and allows for these things to happen with His permission. Another example. The condition of how one high blood pressure affects someone and the disease happens, yes? It is known in the medical world, whatever the conditions to drive you to high blood pressure is known these days. If you go to the doctor and they go, oh, you go, I have high blood pressure, they will tell you, don't do this, don't do this, don't do this. All those elements that lead to high blood pressure are decreed as possibilities and collected all of them in one chapter in the knowledge of Allah. That chapter or that book is called the Book of High Blood Pressure. It could be one gazillion probabilities, but what that means is whenever any of these probabilities take place, high blood pressure happens. You understand? I pray to Allah that I'm succeeding in delivering this topic. So any human that fulfills any of these conditions shall suffer the pains of high blood pressure. So when a human goes and fulfills one or more of these conditions and becomes sick with high blood pressure, they can't blame Allah for that because they have done what deserves them to get the high blood pressure. When someone else is healthy, eating, works out, avoids those things that lead to high blood pressure, they don't get high blood pressure. But the other one is just, it does everything that gets them high blood pressure. You can't accuse Allah, oh, Allah has written on me high blood pressure, that's why I have high blood pressure. No, it is you who has taken the book of high blood pressure, and that's what you got at the end of the day. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ما أصابك من مصيبة في الأرض ولا في أنفسكم إلا في كتاب. There is not a calamity that happens on earth or in yourselves except its conditions of existence have all been written and designed. If it happens to you, it's just you who have gone and dug into that pot, in that book, and you got the disease or the sickness or everything. Another example to highlight this very important and crucial point, because a lot of people blame Allah for the existence of calamities in their own lives. Okay? So for example, HIV. Now, medically speaking, we know how HIV gets transmitted, and it's an STD, sexually transmitted disease. So you know, if you don't want HIV, stop having sex around. That's it. Go get married and stick to one partner, and you will not have HIV. It's not going to happen to you or for the blood and all that kind of stuff. But at least we know the book of HIV and how it gets to you. So don't fulfill the conditions of receiving HIV. Because if you do, Allah will create your HIV for you. And it is very easy for Him to do that. It does. If you go, for example, and you fornicate with someone who has HIV, who is a carrier, and it is, and you are one of the receivers that can be affected, because some people, they become just carriers and are not affected by the disease, by they pass it, with the virus, but they pass it on. Okay, they become like mules, donkeys. But if you are one of these people, you will carry the disease and pass it on to some other people, and you're going to hurt them. Okay, don't blame Allah for that. You have done it yourself. And Allah will make things happen, either for those who believe in Him or for those who do not believe in Him. If a Muslim recites the Quran day and night, donates sadaqah, does everything to the letter, but fornicates, he will get, or she will get HIV, no exception. HIV will happen because the justice of Allah is the book on earth. Whoever fulfills the conditions shall have it. While I am at it, do you know that Japan got struck again with one of the tsunamis? And sadly, the world, the non-Muslim world, Muslim, our Muslims, because Jews and Christians and everyone else is Muslim in the broader sense, but in specific sense, they don't follow our religion. They rush to Japan, help Japan, send helps and all kinds of what they could do to help Japan. But the Arab, the Gulf world, the Salafi world, the Sunni world, it's unbelievable what they did. They started tweeting that what happened to Japan is because they are pagans. They are people who worship idols. They are people who worship rocks. And Allah is angry with them and He punished them. And this is a divine God. And they went ahead and they put on the Twitter some ayat from the Quran that talk about these things. And subhanAllah, the state of Japan wrote a Twitter in Arabic from the government. And it thanked all the world that helped them and also thanked the Muslims for all the tweets and that they are Wathaniyin, pagans worshipping idols, and that they mentioned the Quran. All this is written in the tweet. And then they said that they mentioned the Quran and that we are, and this is the anger of God on us and that we are being punished for our sins. And I felt ashamed for the first time in my life to belong to a group of people that are so worthless, they are so worm-like with a beautiful religion of Islam. Knowing that not a single household, not a single room in the Gulf that doesn't have a Mitsubishi or some kind of Sharp or some Japanese air conditioning unit, if the Japanese decided not to sell units of AC to the Arabs, they will die like rats. And the world will be a better place without them. It's unbelievable how we behave with people. And that is because they don't understand what the word kataba and what Allah has written that happens to mankind. Allah has not written that Japan is like that because of what they believed. No, it just happened that Japan is like that. It's just because they happen to be there and the nature conditions and all that and the interactions with the hot weather and all that kind of stuff. The book of tsunami exists in Japan. If we took every single Salafi, Wahhabi, Sheikh, the most pious ones, and we took them to the island of Japan, guess what? Tsunami is going to hit them. Because tsunami hits, not because of who is there, it's because of the conditions that happen. This is why when Allah punishes a people, He talks about it. And He says, I punished so and so and so. Because punishment usually doesn't happen without the conditions. A tsunami would not just happen like that. When the tsunami happened in Bali, Muslims were circulating the masjid that stood and all that kind of stuff. And the rest of the world has been completely wiped out because they are far, they are this and they are this. And we appear to be the least human people. We don't have an ounce of mercy in our hearts. And then we want the world to look at us. Why the world is not helping Yemen? Why the world is not helping Sudan? Why the world is not helping Palestine? Because the world knows what type of people we are. We even misunderstand our religion. And for the last 1400 years, we have not possibly benefited of the good Islam that is in our heart. Because Allah says in Al-Quran that Al-Quran is a book of barakah. The Muslims, we don't see barakah. We have not seen barakah for the rest of our lives. Yani it's unbelievable. And all this comes because we misunderstand what is in the Quran. We read it according to how we want and how we desire it to be so. I don't know if I have, I will try to wrap up the next ayah in less than 7 minutes and then we'll leave the rest in part number 3. Surah Al-An'am, that is surah number 6, and the ayah is 38. وَمَا مِنْ دَابَّةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا طَائِرٍ يَطِيرُ بِجَنَاحَيْهِ إِلَّا أُمَمٌ أَمْثَالُكُمْ. And no animal that crawls on earth and no bird that flies with its two wings except that they are nations like you. مَا فَرَّطْنَا فِي الْكِتَابِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. We have not overlooked anything in the book. ثُمَّ إِلَى رَبِّهِمْ يُحْشَرُونَ. Then to the Lord will they all be assembled. Al-Qurtubi, Al-Tabari, Ibn Kathir, and many other scholars say that the word kitab here refers to the preserved tablet or the Quran. Subhanallah. Yes, you will find this in the tafsir. They said that the meaning of this ayah, the kitab, the book here, could refer to the preserved tablet or to the Holy Quran. But let us connect with this ayah with the context in which it was mentioned, and the true meaning will jump at us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in ayah number 37, وَقَالُوا, and they said, لَوْلَا نُزِّلَ عَلَيْهِ آيَةٌ مِّن رَبِّهِ, if only a miraculous sign had been sent down to him, on our Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our messenger, from his Lord. قُلْ, answer them by saying, إِنَّ اللَّهَ قَادِرٌ عَلَىٰ أَن يُنَزِّلَ آيَةً وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. Say to them, answer them, saying, surely Allah is capable to send down a sign, but most of them, of those who argue Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or people in general, do not know this fact. وَمَا مِن دَابَّةٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا طَائِرٍ يَطِيرُ بِجَنَاحَيْهِ إِلَّا أُمَمٌ أَمْثَالُكُمْ, and no animal that crawls on earth and no bird that flies with its two wings except are nations like you. مَا فَرَّطْنَا فِي الْكِتَابِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ, we have not overlooked anything in the book. ثُمَّ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يُحْشَرُونَ, then to their Lord they all will be assembled. On the ayah 39, which will help us understand even more, Allah says, وَالَّذِينَ كَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا صُمٌّ وَبُكْمٌ فِي الظُّلُمَاتِ, those who reject, and those who reject our ayat, i.e. of the Quran, are deaf, dumb, and in total darkness. مَنْ يَشَئِ اللَّهُ يُضْلِلَهُ وَمَنْ يَشَأْ يَجْعَلْهُ عَلَىٰ صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ, and this is one of the mostly misunderstood ayat, and I will deal with this when I speak about the will of Allah. Does he will for you misguidance or not? Because in all books of the tafsir, they say whoever Allah wills, this person will be led astray, and whoever Allah wills, this person will be put on a guidance. But this is not what the ayah says. What the ayah says is this: مَنْ يَشَأْ, whoever wills of the humans, then Allah, and takes and does the actions that lead to the guidance, what will Allah do? Allah will guide them. مَنْ يَشَأْ, whoever wills, Allah will guide him. And on the other hand, and whoever wills to be misguided, guess what? Allah will put him on a misguided path. Let me give you an example. If you want to do good, you want to donate some money, guess what? You start looking for people to donate money to. Lo and behold, Allah facilitates that action, and you find a poor person and you give them money. So you wanted to donate, you have willed that, you wanted to do that. Guess what Allah did? Allah then brought you what you needed to fulfill what you wanted to do in the first place. Now let's take somebody who wants to fornicate. Guess what? They will do what it needs to be done to reach a partner, another person, male or female. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to, let's assume it's a man, because usually this happens a lot in the male. Let's assume this guy wants to commit fornication. Allah is not suddenly going to hide all women so that this man cannot fornicate, unless Allah wants to do a specific favor to that person for one thing, then he doesn't let it happen. But in normal circumstances, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't want to help, guess what? You want to fornicate, you go on the internet, you research, and you do everything that you want to fornicate. And what does Allah do? He just makes your action happen. Allah here is very, he's totally impartial for the good and the evil. You want to do good, he makes it easy for you. You want to do bad, he makes it easy for you. Allah is not going to tell you, don't do. Allah has already issued a book, sent you messengers. Now you know what's good and what's the evil. As you can see, this ayah is part of a block which deals with the challenge that the kuffar of Quraysh had said to the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam when they wanted Allah to send a clear message to them, so that they believe that the man in front of them is truly a messenger from Allah. And for that, they questioned as to why no miraculous signs were given to him as a forewarning. Why didn't Allah send a big, huge, really clear miracle? And with that, we will believe in him. And this also explains why the moon has not been divided into two, as they claim in the books of the biography of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah did not make the moon split into two so that the kuffar of Quraysh would say, oh, the moon is not into two, we believe. No. And I'll speak about this later on, inshallah. So Allah answers this very capable, this very question, and he says that he is capable of sending down a huge sign, a huge creature, a huge miracle, right? For you, for them to believe them. But since initially they don't believe in Allah, and they have not done what it will lead them to believe, then Allah is not gonna make that happen. But on judgment day, Allah will resurrect them all. And that's why he says, ثُمَّ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يُحْشَرُونَ. Then Allah will bring back all of them, every creature that has walked on earth, every bird that has flown, all those people are in the book of actions of Allah, and that book will be brought out on Judgment Day. Remember, Al-Imam Al-Mubin, where all of our actions have been written. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, my dear sisters, la ilaha illallah, what our books of tafsir say about this topic is really beyond belief. In other words, just to close this third ayah, in other words, Allah makes things happen and he doesn't interfere with your choice, If you want to be guided and do what it needs to be guided, Allah gives you guidance. If you want to be rich and you do what it needs to be done to become rich, Allah gives you richness. If you want to be broke and do what it needs to be done to be broke, you will be broke. No one has ever been totally broke, and out of nowhere a bag fell from heaven and that's it, he became rich. We need, if you want to succeed and have a PhD, you need to do what it needs to be done to get the PhD, and then Allah makes it happen. If you don't do what it needs to be done to get a PhD, by you not succeeding, it is Allah that made that not happen. It's past the hour, so I'm going to stop here. And inshallah, in the next talk, bi'illah, I shall carry on with the ayah number 4. And that is, وَمَا مِنْ غَائِبَةٍ فِي السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ إِلَّا فِي كِتَابٍ مُبِينٍ. And there is nothing that is hidden, be it in the heavens or the earth, but is recorded in a clear book. And we will see in what context this ayah has been revealed. And does it mean that everything is already pre-recorded, pre-designed, pre-everything? Or does it hold another meaning? Again, this is your brother Abdul Salam Abu Hanif, and you know the drill. If you want to join my group, please do send me a message on WhatsApp, 078-7640-8735, and I am in England, so +44, that should get me here. Otherwise, just go on my YouTube channel on Islam Pep Talk, and subscribe there, and you will get notified. You press the button for notification on all that kind. You already know the drill, so you do that, and I'll see you on part 3. Allah helps us all. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.